The Quest for Truth by Paravastu Surya Narayana. The True Story of an Earnest Search for God. The heart of God yearns over his earthly children with a love stronger than death. The same divine mind that is working upon the things of nature is speaking to the hearts of men and creating an inexpressible craving for something they have not. The things of the world cannot satisfy their longings. The Spirit of God is pleading with them to seek for those things that alone can give peace and rest. Wisdom crieth out without. She uttereth her voice in the streets. She crieth in the chief place of concourse. In the openings of the gates in the city she uttereth her word, saying, How long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity? Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you. Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded, but he hath set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as a desolation and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from the fear of evil. This entire selection is translated from the original language into English and brought to you in the first person. It is desired that you listen to the whole tape before you come to any conclusions. The text in Sanskrit is retained and spoken in its originality by the author himself for the purpose of clarity and authenticity. Listen to the startling truth with patience, for it'll reveal the things that you are seeking to find. It will be an answer to the deep yearnings of your mind. It will even change your life.
Puranamityevana sadhu sarvam napachikamyam navamidhyamadhyam santaha parichyanyatarad bhajante Mudaha parapratyaya neya buddhihi.
The great poet Kalidas had once said that every old thing is not worth retaining, neither every new thing worth discarding. Every true seeker will discern and find the truth for himself, while the fools depend upon the wisdom of the wise. Dear friends, examine the truths that I am about to expound with the help of God's given wisdom. Search, investigate, and ascertain for yourself as to what is truth and what is error. Now, just a few facts about myself. In my early years, I was sent to one of the first four schools called Puri Jagannatha Math, established in India in the early 7th century by Adi Shankaracharya. Here they trained the young minds in Vedas and other sacred writings. I was thus sent to receive knowledge and understanding of the various writings in those schools. Our subjects under study were Puranas, Vedas, Upanishads. I had received the training for a period of 7.5 years. During the course of my study, I had discovered few facts that demanded further clarification and explanation. On approaching my teachers for further details, they reprimanded me, sternly saying that I had been sent here as a student and therefore it was my obligation to submit and learn and not cross-question the superiors. If you insist in your ways, they told me, that it will show ill manners and unwillingness to be submissive to your teachers, and we would have no choice but to expel you from school because of your ill discipline. I therefore humbly submitted myself till I completed the training of 7.5 years. After this, I approached them and shared them my discovery and the truths that I had stumbled across. These then are some of those samples that I had uncovered. The first text is taken from Ramayana, written by Valmiki, from the selection called Aranyakanda, the wilderness experience, the 63rd Swarga and the 4th Sloka.
Purvam mayanuna mabhichitani papani karmanya akrutkrutani tatra madhyapatito vipako dukhena dukkam yadaham visami.
Here Sri Rama, testifying about himself, says that in my past life I had surely committed many transgressions or sins, and as a result I am paying the penalty through these sufferings and sorrows. I then asked my superior, saying, in this very first Ramayana written by Valmiki himself, I had found this strange passage, whereas according to our traditions handed down to us, we are taught that Sri Rama is God, and we therefore have been worshipping him from the past ages along with our countrymen. But according to this fact mentioned here, it says that Sri Rama had in his past life committed many sins and therefore took this incarnation to pay the penalty in the form of these sorrows. What do you say about this? How can we solve this contradiction? I added further, saying, how can he who has sinned be called God? Thus Sri Rama is not God, according to his own testimony which he had spoken. Why then should we worship him? Why don't we tell this truth to the whole world and make the people aware of this fact? As a result, they became furious at me and dismissed me from that school. I tried to discuss with them plainly, but on further discovery, they expelled me and sent me home. My parents, on finding out the reason, got angry and exclaimed that it is no surprise that I happened to do this way, because when I was born, my stars and my palmistry showed that I would become rebellious. I then stayed at home. Please don't come to quick conclusions that I am being critical and raising a lot of unnecessary dust. But as I reveal these facts to you, inspect, investigate, and according to what Kalidas had said, evaluate with the eye of understanding and wisdom, and then conclude for yourself the reasonableness of these sayings. I am also giving you the quotations from where these passages have been selected. Buy these books for yourself, search them thoroughly and settle it in your mind, and wholeheartedly follow the truth. This then is my heartfelt prayer. Let us have a look at few examples. Earlier I was quoting to you what Sri Rama had testified about himself, but now look at what Vaimana says in his book called Arya Kavitantro Upadgatamu, pages 11 to 14.
Kanakamrugamu bhuvani kaddule danakano తరుణ విడిచి చెన్నయ్య దాశరథియు బుధులేని వాడు దేవుడెట్లాయరా విశ్వదాభిరామ వినరవేమ అని పదం.
This was written in the 13th century by Vaimana. We are now looking at the incident taking place in the wilderness where Rama, Lakshmana and Sita were residing. Suddenly there appeared before them a golden deer. Of course it was sent by Ravana. Fascinated by this, Sita implored Rama to fetch it. On hearing this request, Rama went after the deer to satisfy the desires of Sita. Now commenting on this aspect, Vaimana writes, saying that how can he be God who foolishly had left his wife in the wilderness and went after the animal without a second thought? After I began to perceive these things clearly, I wanted to tell my countrymen that Rama was not God after all. This being established by his own witness, where Rama confesses that he had sinned in his past life and had taken this avatar to pay the penalty. The second witness being Vaimana in the 13th century expresses to the same fact. Notice, all this is not what I am concocting by myself, but I am plainly revealing what has been already written. Look at another one written in Devya Bhagavatam, Swastamaskandam, in the 10th chapter. Listen to this, what Vyasi, the great sage, is saying.
Kapam karoti manujastatha deva dayopicha tathanarayano rajan narascha dharmaja ubhau jatau krishna arjune कामासौ नारायणस्य सौ पुराण पीठिकेयम् वै मुनिभिः परिकीर्तितौ.
Here it says, O king, man is continuing to sin in the same way as the angels or devatas are committing sin. Even the very sons of Dharma, who are the sages, namely Narayana and Narudu, similarly are committing sin. And as a result, both these brothers were born as Krishna and Arjuna. We know this fact, O king, as it is recited by the sages, written in Puranas and Purana Pitas. Now this author, Vyasi, is called as Vyadavyasi. He is the same author of the complete Ramayana. Here he affirms that the sages themselves proclaim that the sons of Dharma or justice, namely Narayana and Narudu, who were once in the past great sages, were involved in sin just like mortal men. Therefore they were born as Krishna and Arjuna to pay the penalty for their own sins. But surprisingly, the same writer, Vyasi, in another passage taken from Bhagavad Gita, says that Sri Krishna had come into the world as God. Now how do we solve this discrepancy? Let us first listen to this passage. Dear people, in earnest search for God, discern with understanding. As you listen to this. This is taken from Bhagavad Gita in the section Jnana Yogam 4 and 8.
Paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya chatuskrutam dharma samstapanardaye sambhavami yuge yuge.
Here Sri Krishna, testifying about himself, says, I have taken this incarnation or avatar to establish truth and justice on earth and to destroy wicked ones in every generation and in every age. But you notice here that the same writer in Purana Pita says that Krishna was born to pay the penalty as a consequence of sin. Now these two statements are quite contradictory, isn't it? Now both the statements don't agree with each other. How then do you solve this problem? The truth is, many people think that Bhagavad Gita was written by Vyasi himself, but it is not so. Going back into history, we understand that Bhagavad Gita was written by Shyati. Shyati was a poor Brahmin who had very little understanding in the hidden meanings of the Vedas, much less the Puranas. But still, with his understanding, he had written the Bhagavad Gita to earn a living. He then came to the well-known sage Vyadavyasi and submitted it to him. Now Vyasi got this Bhagavad Gita right on time when he was contemplating as to how to make his half-written Mahabharata complete. He then bought it from the Brahmin and inserted or included in the half-completed Mahabharata, making it Sampurna Mahabharata. If in case Vyadivyasi was the same writer of Bhagavad Gita as the Puranas, he then would not have written that Krishna was God in Bhagavad Gita, contradictory to what he had written earlier in the Puranas, saying that Krishna had sinned. As he was not the author of Bhagavad Gita, without much evaluation of it, he inserted it into the story of Mahabharata. To remind you again, this is not trying to pick flaws or being critical, but bringing true facts to light. Truth will always withstand investigation. Looking at another saying from Skanda Purana in the section entitled Rudrakoti Mahatyam, the 7th chapter, we find this.
Tato Vishnu samagatya pranamya munipingavam pramado drohamarabdham samayeste tvabhyachitah.
Here Adi Vishnu goes to the great sage Dhruva. After greeting him, he implores, saying, O sage, I had come all the way to you to seek pardon and forgiveness for the mistake I had committed. Therefore, please pardon me. Again, the question I'm asking you is, how can he who commits sin be called God? The one who sins is a sinner. This is naked truth. You can't try to refute it. This very saying is taken from Skanda Purana, where Vishnu confesses to the fact that he had transgressed and is in great need of forgiveness. The reason why I am emphasizing all this is because I had functioned as a chief priest in the temple of Lakshmi Narayana. While I was serving as a priest handed over to me from my ancestors, I began to search and study the writings and the history, after which I had come to this conclusion that these so-called gods who are worshipped are not truly gods, because they do not have the characteristics of Godhead. I then had the earnest desire to make known these facts to my people here in India. Hence I am doing what I am doing now. Dear beloved people of my country, pay heed to these truths. Don't just let your passions rise, because that will hinder your fine judgment. The facts are all before you. Hear and comprehend. If in doubt, buy these books for yourself and search diligently till you find this truth for yourself. In Vishnu Puranam, the 10th chapter and the 6th verse, this is what Shri Krishna is saying again.
Sodasahastra Sundari Janamohitudagana Nenopudane Darimpanamida Kurmi Yendadanu Bayadatagunaya Satyabhamaka Bunpashakiledu ప్రతిదినంబు మత్స్యపానంబు గావించు బలభద్రునకు భరింపగరాదు సతులతో గూడి సంసారములు చేసిన వారెవరును దాల్పలేరు భూమి.
Here Krishna says that I am totally unworthy to wear this Shamataka mani, this precious stone that sheds dazzling light and glory. It is because I move with women and I am desirous of them, and therefore I am not worthy. Not only me, but also Balarama, who takes intoxicating drinks, is also unworthy to adorn the precious stone. Not just us, but anyone on earth who is having marital relationship is unworthy to wear that stone of light. Now consider this. God is light. He is the only one worthy to adorn himself with light. How can he be called as God who is unworthy and shrinks at light? He who is unworthy of light, how can he be called as light and God? These are the very words spoken by Krishna himself. Now listen to all this with contemplation, because in this country of mine, the people are being deceived into thinking that these people are verily gods, being deluded by people like us who pose themselves as priests and Brahmins and enlightened people, who only mislead the people just to make more money and to earn a living. This then is my burden, to bring to light all these facts. Look at another passage that is written.
Ichidvachanam chutya prajapati tata bravit ajnanadavamanena savitri kupita gata adhanarayana putram vilindyamati vajjitam.
We are looking at the passage from Skanda Purana under the section Patitirtha Mahatyam, the 8th chapter. Here Brahma himself is saying, confessing his sin, that I had listened to Narayana's words. Narayana is Brahma's father or Vishwamurti or the life giver of all. Now there are various meanings to the word Narayana. Nara means water, Ainudu means he who makes water or the clouds his waker and moves on it or travels on it. Now here Brahma says, I had listened to my father Narayana's words, and in my insanity and foolishness had insulted Savitri. And because of this shameful deed, Savitri in her anger had left me and went her way. This is what the creator Brahma is saying. In response, Narayana is consoling his son for his foolishness. Dear beloved, can anyone be called God who persuades others to commit sin? Or he who commits sin can be called God? Or can he be the creator? Look at another instant about Shankara or Shiva, who is conspiring to assassinate Brahma, the creator, and suffering the penalty, went to the great sage Narada, and thus he says in this way.
Ahimtva aparadana malayo kinchinogati svameva upayo bhuto me bhaveti prardhanamati Saranagatarityuktasadevosman.
This is taken from Visvaksenu Samhita Rudra Naro Samhada, where Shiva or Shankara is saying about himself to Narada. Here he says, I am prone to sinning. Verily there lies no truth in me. I am just full of sin. O Narada, teach me a solution for this. Be thou the solver of this problem. You are my only hope. I come to you with meekness. You forgive me and show me the way. O people of this country, listen with earnest ears. Now from all the selections that you have been hearing, is there a single person that I have named that did not commit sin? How can a person who is not righteous be called God? God is not a person who can sin. But here is God pleading for forgiveness from a mortal sage. How astonishing it is. What is truth then? Truth is that which is free from error or falsehood. It can withstand any kind of investigation. It does not just whittle down even through the minutest detail on investigation. Therefore, I implore you, cleave to that which is pure and leave that which is untruth. Here is another saying from Devya Bhagavatam, the fourth portion and the eighth chapter.
Tatharudraste chahankara mohita brahmaschasmin mahagade samsare nrupasattama.
O King, all the three gods, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, because of their iniquity and foolishness, are wading or sinking in the great ocean of marital responsibilities. How strange! What is then the difference between us mortal beings and the so-called gods? If they also are prone to error and subject to the burdens of earthly life, where then is the dividing line? Have you at any time come across such passages? Have you heard them? Have they been declared to you at any time by the so-called light bearers? Everyone aims at exploiting the others for their money with just a mere wave of blessing, or with a mantra attempting to diffuse the curses that fall on us. They pretend to bless you in your marriages with great sanctimonious austerity. Who among them had been so concerned enough to declare this truth to you? Since the whole destiny of your life hangs upon this path that we are following, how careful had they been to tell you the truth? Listen, O mankind who has a thirst for truth, why don't you evaluate for yourself and find whether what is spoken holds water? Search deeply, not with disturbed passions, but with patience. After a while, you will hear what the consequences I am bearing to declare this truth to you. Now consider another selection from Mahaparshutu, the third chapter.
Brahma, Vishnu, Rudrascha, Sarvava Bhuta, Jatayaha, Nasame, Vanu, Dhavanti, Salilani, Vabadavam.
It says, just like how the litter is consumed in the fire for destruction, even so Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara, along with all those who are born with the aid of five forces on earth, are heading towards destruction, a total annihilation and hellfire. Frightening, isn't it? O people, how can we ever hope of securing eternal life by worshipping those who are headed towards destruction? Where then is the hope for mankind? How sad! How really sad it is. Don't think that I'm just being critical. Because of the deep burden and love I have towards you, I'm taking all the pain to declare this to you. You may have been following untruth out of ignorance or without knowledge, but perceive the truth now and see the difference for yourself and follow carefully. If you persist to cling to these falsehoods, you have chosen your own course. I cannot compel you. But it is my bounden duty to declare this truth to you, whatever may be the consequence. Listen to Sri Ranga Mahatyam, the seventh chapter.
Yamanunadi Kamakroda Vasaserve Devashin Pitru Manavaha Anaga.
Here is a plain fact stating that all the heavenly gods, which includes the 332 crores of them, along with Pitru Devatas and human beings, are infested with passions and lusts, kama and krodha, and have been rotten to the very core. Look at another saying from Aryatantra Upad Gatamu, the 12 to 14 pages.
This is what
Mahadi Vishnu says. O mankind, Why are you in vain seeking for salvation or moksha during your lifetime on earth? In other words, it's just a mere waste of time searching for salvation or hoping for moksha. Then what then should I do? Therefore, enjoy yourself with all the sumptuous and palatable foods that you can secure. If you can't buy, if you're poor, beg and enjoy. If not, steal. Steal and enjoy them. Enjoy not only with all the palatable foods, but enjoy with all the women that your eye desires. How astonishing it is. How shocking, how detestable. How can anyone who claims to be God speak such abominations? In Vishwamitra Vasistha Samhada, this is also what Vishwamitra declares to the great sage Vasistha.
Asura asura yachagana gandharva varulandu mariyuna varulayandu vankani varala bodagana memu sankarunana mujjagamula yandu.
Among all the beings existing in the three worlds, that is the gods of heaven, the human beings and the Rakshasas, there is not even one single truthful person existing. There is none who does not commit sin. Every single being is a sinner. The whole universe is packed with sin and sinners. Not one holy being exists. Stunning, isn't it? It is time to check the platform on where we stand, dear friends. And where are we hankering our very hopes? Notice, these are the very sayings of Vishwamitra. Now don't just simply give up. It is also unfair for the intellectuals to brush it aside by saying, we never believed in these things anyway. They're all fables. We knew them beforehand that they're all fables. No, it is not that simple. There is no value to superficial conclusions. Nothing becomes false because someone says it is so. One must investigate intensely and come to clear conclusions, because there is truth somewhere and we need to find it. I have come to these conclusions after I have searched through all these books for myself. Let us then think for a moment. Who are these gods? Who are these angels? Where and what are these sacred writings? Ponder wisely. Do they really deserve our worship? Aren't they all liars? Haven't they said it about themselves that they are all heading towards destruction and death and oblivion? Contemplate. Contemplate for your own self. It is really high time that we know where we stand. During my schooling in Puri Jagannatha Mahapita, I told my superiors this very fact, that propagating that which is not truth as truth and encouraging the people to worship those who are not gods as gods, thus making the whole world to hang their hopes on a false foundation, aren't we instigating the wrath of God on ourselves? If we deliberately go against our conscience, will God ever forgive us? He cannot forgive the willful diversion. Yet I think it is still not too late for us, I told them. Let us all now with unity go to the people and with one voice declare the truth about the true God, saying, there is purity only in God, and only in the path of righteousness can we discover divinity, because God means truth and God is truth. Therefore, I suggested to them that we shall clearly expose the error on where we are standing and tell the truth about God to the people. At this, my superiors became furious and sent me home. Of course, I began to understand the reason. If these facts are disclosed to the people, these priests will lose their respect and become cheap in the society. Their means of income will be dried up. Respect and all honor will be totally lost. People will no longer worship wood, stone, metal, animals, snakes and birds, and as a result they cannot practice the profession. They will no more be highly honored and regarded. Their sanctimonious services all will be halted. O people, is this the only avenue to earn a living? Is there no better way? Oh, how painful even to think about it. Now, fearing such consequences, they dismissed me from that school. After this, I was anointed and initiated as a chief priest in Lakshminarayana temple. The added reason was because I was the firstborn in my family and I had to take up the responsibilities of the priesthood. It was during that time I was intensely studying from the books and the traditions and the rituals, the sayings, because without this we could not function as priests in the temple. I did this for 7.5 years under the guidance of the elders, such as my grandparents, uncles and my parents, where I was serving in the temple, and I followed the instructions directed by them. Then one day I happened to come across a strange passage recorded in Samveda. Listen to this carefully.
Lishvya Goptaram Mahatyo Dajana Kuryante Avyayana Paryatasin.
It says that the true incarnate of God, or the avatar, will be born through the womb of a virgin, born in a stable or a cattle shed. After this, I began to contemplate deeply upon this subject, because according to our belief in the five Dharma Shastras, there are only 10 avatars, namely Varna avatar, Kurma avatar, Matsya avatar, Narsimha avatar, Vaman avatar, Rama avatar, Krishna avatar. But in all these avatars, not one of them was born of a virgin, and that too in a stable. If the true incarnate was not to be found in the 10 avatars, where else can it be found? Would he appear in this age? For it looks like a new and a strange avatar to me. I then began a deep and intense study with a sincere desire to find out about this particular incarnation. I began to gather all the facts that were available to me that could be gleaned. I thought to myself that if I can write a book about this avatar and present it to the government, they would greatly honor me from this noble discovery. And with this interest in my mind, I commenced my research. I began to search in the deep arches of the temple where all the collections of various saints and books were kept. Also alongside with them were the old parchments written by our ancestors. While at study, I stumbled over this passage. This is taken from Samyoda, the second half of Tandya Mahabrahmana.
Prajapatir Devebhyam Atmanam Yajnam Krutva Prayasit.
Here the great God of the universe, the one who rules the people, the Creator, is performing a strange act. In order to pay the penalty or the payment for sin, to atone for that very sin, the God of heaven is offering his own body as a sacrifice, allowing it to be bruised and consumed in the earth. Here the God of the universe, the one who rules the people, the Creator, is performing a strange act. In order to pay the penalty or the payment for sin, to atone for sin itself, the God of heaven is offering his own body as a sacrifice to be bruised and consumed in that very fire. I then began to contemplate on this aspect of God offering himself as a sacrifice, being consumed for the forgiveness and the payment of sin. But the question came in my mind, for whose sins is he offering his body? This was the doubt I had in my mind, and as I read further, I found this passage.
Sarva papa pariharo ratta prokshanam avashyakam tadraktam paramatmena punyadana baliyagam.
It says, if you need freedom and forgiveness of sins, of all types of sins, like the lust of the eyes, the sins of the ears, deliberate sins, sins of the mind, pride, arrogance, ego, selfishness, anger, bitterness, and all the deep and hidden sins of the mind, there must be shedding of blood. For without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness or the remission of sins. But then, whose blood should be shed? Whose blood should it be?
Sadratnam paramatmena.
Unless God himself sheds his precious blood, there can be no forgiveness or pardon for mankind, because it is against him that we sin, and his blood or life has the ability to pay the penalty for all types of sins. I can remember a prayer that I had memorized in my childhood days, which I used to recite as a priest in my temple. It is taken from Manuskriti, the fourth chapter, called The Prayer of the Dawn by Manu.
Malboham papakarmaham papatma papasambhava trahimam krupaya deva saranagata vatsala.
O Lord, I took my birth in sin, I grew up in sin, and I am consumed in sin. Therefore I come to you in all meekness. Have mercy on me and pardon me and deliver me from sin. Man by birth has been born in sin, and without exception everyone through transgression have come short of receiving the glory and are being destroyed. Unless God Himself comes to the rescue, the destiny of mankind is utterly hopeless. Unless God volunteers to offer His life as a sacrifice on behalf of man, in vain is man's existence. But who is this God who had come into the world to freely give Himself as a sacrifice, allowing His body to be crushed and bruised, thus shedding His own blood and offering His very life as a substitute to rescue man headed towards eternal destruction? We have read earlier that unless God sheds His own blood, there is no atonement for sin, because we cannot atone for our own sins. When the sins of mankind are washed in His blood, which represents the life He offered, then on that merit can man be forgiven of his past sins, cleansed from every defilement of sin and made righteous, giving him hope for the future. My question was, from whom can I find such deliverance? In my study I found out that no avatar had at any time bruised his body as a sacrifice and shed his blood to offer forgiveness and salvation to lost humanity. I could not find answers among the 10 avatars. But the Hindu Dharma Shastra speaks of only 10 avatars, and there was no provision for the 11th one, whereas according to the Samveda, the true avatar should be manifested. Why then was this avatar not included with the others? Why was it disclosed from the public? Why was it masked? Quite strangely, only in this avatar the whole redemption and salvation of mankind hangs, and yet this has been undermined. While in all the 10 avatars there occurred no redemption, cleaning back or rescue of mankind, these facts had become so vivid to me as I searched through the passages. Now in Dravida Yogam, it emphasizes this way.
Yajnavapati yajname rakshinchano.
Only true sacrifice or yajna has the power to free the sinner from the clutches and the bondage of sin and its penalty, thus giving them the heritage and inheritance of eternal life. The Aryas clarified it by saying that simply any type of sacrifice is not just adequate. The yajna officiated with mere human hands or sinners is still contaminated with corruption, which cannot be a real substitute for the consequence of sin. Only when the sacrifice or yajna is ministered with holy hands or the sinless one, then the sacrifice is capable of paying for the penalty of sin. God is the only one who is faultless. He is absolutely holy. He will not sin, neither does He tempt others to do so. He does not lie, neither does He cause others to do so. Thus the Aryas had concluded that truly unless God, because of His mercy, offers Himself as a sacrifice, there can be no salvation for sinners.
Om Bhurbhavah Svah Tat Savitur Virenyam Bhurogadimasya Dhimahi Dhyo Yonah Prachodayat.
This is taken from Yajurveda, the 36th chapter and the 3rd verse. It says, God is the self-existent one, not made with human hands. He is invisible because He dwells in light where no sinner can approach. Om means self-existent God, and the one who comes from Him is called Aham, or the Son of God. Only when the Son of God or Aham volunteers to become as a sacrifice, to take our place as a substitute, offering His body to be wounded, thus shedding His blood, thereby giving up His life for us, there is no pardon for sinful man. By this I understood that I am a sinner, because I was born as one, and I must be released from its bondage and become holy. Till then I cannot find true peace and happiness. Interestingly, according to Yajurveda, it says that when I was ordained as a priest, my sins were forgiven, and that I had taken a new birth from then on as a priest or a Brahmana. With this I became absolutely holy and righteous, and remained so because of my holy office. But during my priesthood, as I was officiating in the temple, I knew the sins I had committed in secret, the pride, ego, selfishness, arrogance, partaking of intoxicating drinks. No one knew about it. None of my elders could see except the one who is holy and righteous above, the God of heaven, who can search the deepest depths of the thoughts and the intents of the heart and discern the hidden secrets of my mind, the Omniscient One. He is the All-Knowing One. He knew it. Taking up the priesthood did not free me from the grips of sin. I realized that it had no value at all. Although Ayurveda, the 36th chapter and the 3rd sloka, affirmed that I became holy, I understood that I could become holy only first when God had come to this earth, when He had taken my sin upon Himself and giving His life by shedding His blood, and then offering me His righteousness and purity. Then and then only can I have this privilege that was offered to me. As this concept had been dawning upon my mind, I saw another passage from Devyo Bhagavatam.
Kanna kootarunu bharyaga jesukunnatti madhavasutudu kamakudu gade suragurasachito marukeligudina marikashyapundu kamakudu gade.
Here Brahma, who wanted to create mankind, first formed a woman. After she became alive, he became so enticed with his own creation, that is his daughter, that he embraced her and made her his wife. In another instant, he committed sin with Brihaspati's wife. Thus, in payment for these sins and to pay for the penalty of his own sin, he offers his body to be burned in Igna, suffering the consequences of his own sin that he had committed. Yes, here Brahma offered Igna, but it was for himself. What he did was not for the rescue of mankind. With this sacrifice of Brahma, there is no hope or forgiveness of salvation for mankind. Are we then doomed for destruction? Have we no hope at all? No assurance? No consolation? Who then can deliver us from this bondage of evil? One hot summer morning, in the month of June, the earth was parched and radiating with heat. The people of the village came to me and suggested that we offer a sacrifice so that we can invoke God for a blessing of rain. They made some contributions toward this, and along with the temple money, totally making up to 10,000 rupees, I went to the nearby town to buy the ingredients for the sacrifice. And there I heard the voice of singing through a loudspeaker saying, "Thou art the Holy One who was born through the Virgin in a stable. Taking the form of mankind, you are the Righteous One who was born to give us forgiveness." I became speechless for a moment, because I happened to recollect the conclusions that I had got after 7.5 years of study and research. Strange, they are just echoing the very questionings of my mind, I thought. Perhaps they might guide me or show me some way where I can purchase the book or find out the information about this truth or the avatar that I was seeking for. I was anxiously looking forward to it, and therefore with hurried steps I turned towards the direction from where I heard the voice. There I saw a group of people sitting with their musical instruments and singing cheerfully. Later on I had come to know that they were Christians. There was a van standing nearby with some verses written on it, and they were selling Bibles. But I thought to myself, what have I got to do with this low-caste fellows? How in the world would these people know the deep and hidden secrets of the Holy God written in Upanishads and Vedas? With this I turned back and I began to reflect in my mind these thoughts, saying, but why should I bother about these people and their background? After all, I am searching for this incarnate person that I am looking forward to, where there is hope and salvation. Let me go and purchase the book and find the information. If I get there, that's enough. Why should I bother about these people? So saying, I went back. Now my appearance totally looked like the adornment of a priest. As I arrived there, I heard the preacher saying, Jesus is the only Savior. He is the only God. Unless one believes in Him, there is no hope of eternal life. And since Jesus is coming back soon, accept Him and be saved, or else you'll be subject to eternal fire. Oh, I thought to myself, what is he saying? How is he saying that Jesus is the only God and that if we don't believe in Him, we have no hope at all? Anyway, I thought, let me go about my business. I stood for a moment, and after his sermon, the preacher came over to me and inquired about my details. I replied that I served as a priest in the temple and we have lots of land and property, but actually come here to find out the history of a historical person that I have been researching. He then asked me who it was. I told him that this was the conclusion that I had come to. Now these books tell us about the one who was born of a virgin in the stable, the incarnate one, who had come to give forgiveness for the sins of all mankind, and the one who has offered his body as a sacrifice to be bruised and shed his blood for the remission of all sins. And only in that blood there is true redemption and hope for mankind. I heard your people singing this theme in your song, and had come to inquire about the details of this person, the incarnate one. Please, can you help me find the records of this historical person? If you don't have these records, please show me where I can buy it. And this is the reason why I had come to you. At this, he exclaimed, "Is Christ recorded in the Vedas?" Oh, in my mind I thought to myself, who is this Christ? This is not what I asked him. He then continued with praises and thanksgiving to the great God, thanking Jesus for his benevolence and his mercy for revealing himself in various ways. And then he said, "What is your name?" I told him it was Paravastu Surya Narayana. He asked me, "Do you come from the lineage of Paravastu Chennai Suri?" I answered yes. And then he continued saying, "What you had actually discovered are the details of Jesus' birth, his death, resurrection and the shedding of blood. You will find this Jesus in this Bible. If you read this Bible, the facts that you have gleaned in the Vedas and Upanishads, you can find in much greater detail in this book. This is the book that you just need. Take it, read it. You'll find what you're looking for in this book. And it'll be a thrilling experience for you and your heart." In one way, I had a hesitation also, because I began to think, why should I take the book of these low caste people? After all, would they find this truth? Do they have it? But inwardly I thought to myself, anyway, I needed to satisfy the curiosity and the search of this history of this great person. Let me go over and look. Maybe I can find the meaning and the answers. I can write a book and present it to the government and they will honor me. And this was my great intention. With this, I took the book and went back home. For 2.5 years, I read the book in the night after night. After everyone had slept, I offered all the lights, and with the help of the lamp that was fed with ghee in the bleaking light, till 2 to 3 a.m., I began to search intensely and read the Bible. By 2.5 years, I completed reading the Bible already twice. I then found a truth that is recorded in Isaiah, the 7th chapter, verse 14, where it says, "For a virgin shall conceive and give birth to a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel." But he did not understand the meaning of Emmanuel, because there was no one to expound the meaning of Emmanuel to me. All that I had in my company were these books along with the Bible. There was none to help me. Then I found another truth that is recorded in the book of Luke, where it says, "Because there was no place in the inn, Jesus was born in a stable." As I was contemplating upon the themes, I fell asleep. Later on, after a while, all the elders got together and reminded me that they should visit the homes of the disciples, that is, the people of other castes, because our religion tells us that we have about 5,000 disciples, and every year for about 1 to 2 months we visit the homes of these people, accept the gifts that they offer, and if anyone was interested in becoming a Vaishnava, we would initiate them in the caste by giving them a metallic bangle burnt in ghee flame. And they, according to the ancient tradition, will make us stand in front of the house, wash our legs with saffron water and place flowers and greet us. We then return a blessing to them. This was the custom that they followed. While on this tour on the 4th day, it came to my mind those very sayings that I had read. And it came so sharply that I am a sinner. And how will these people obtain salvation by worshipping me, a sinner?
Avasyam anubhoktavyam kritam karma subhasubham.
It says, you'll reap what you sow and you'll get what you pay for. I understood that there is only one who deserves worship, and that is God in heaven. If I accept the worship from human beings, my sin will become more grievous and thus subject myself to eternal fire. Thus, one night I took a very firm decision. The following day, as we visited the first house, the householder came forward to wash my feet, for which I strongly objected. At this, my uncles and my elders came forward and questioned my objection. I then recited the prayer recorded in Manuskriti, the early morning prayer. It says, I am a sinner, born in sin, I grew up in sin and being consumed in sin. We are all sinners by birth along with other human beings. How can we accept the worship from human beings? I object to this worship, I told them. If you need, you can go forward, but I am not coming with you. At this we had some very strong arguments, which made them very angry and furious. They manhandled me before the other people. They insulted me thoroughly. And therefore, I decided to go back home. After this, we all came to the temple of Lakshmi Narayana. They then brought all the writings and the books and told me that I had actually become holy. You are not a sinner anymore. When you took up your priesthood, you became totally holy. And according to Yajurveda, the 33rd chapter and the 6th verse, you are now a holy person. Yes, it was true that I was initiated into priesthood and wear the sacred thread. But this is also what Vemana had said.
జనకాలమందు జన్ని దంబులు లేవు, తల్లిమిడను లేవు, తనకు లేవు, నడుమ జంజమేయనకు బాటుగాదర విశ్వదాభిరామ వినరవేమ.
I did not inherit the sacred thread by birth, but what I inherited was sin. Hence, sin is haunting me. Although I had been initiated by wearing the sacred thread, sin did not leave me. Neither the thread nor the Ajna was able to separate me from sin or from its influence. I am still a slave to sin. I was not yet made free. My conscience, which is illuminated by the Divine Spirit, tells me. Although out of fear, I could not express this to them. I remained silent, but I was stubborn in my persistence that it was impossible for me to continue this profession of priesthood anymore. I then went into the temple and spent the whole night contemplating. My folks came over to me and implored me to listen, that actually we were masters, we became gurus. For this, I told them the meaning of what a true guru is.
Guru anaga paramatmudu paraganga shishyudanaga bhatu jeevudagun guru shishya jeeva sampadala guru tarumuga gochuratade guru vagavema.
Who is the true guru? Only God is the master or the true guru. We, by taking that place, are devoting the worship to ourselves, I told them. Now that mistake had been committed, let us as true guides divert the attention of worship to the true God. We who have misrepresented the truth and turned the truth into fables and are being worshipped are downright sinners, not gurus or leaders at all. I also reminded them of what Vemana had said.
Lokamulaku guruvu, lokulaku guruvu, adi telisi moksha mandagori gurini ganaka naraka kopamandari.
Saying guru and guru, people desperately run after the gurus for moksha and eternal life. But in despair they have not obtained it, but rather are being subject to eternal damnation. We as priests are also heading forward for that destruction, and they who follow us are also in the same path. With this they became extremely furious and bound me hand and foot and bashed me up, and for 3 days made me fast. Exhausted after 3 days, I begged for pardon, for which they released me. After a few days I got courage. Then early one morning I got and arranged the mic system present in the temple, which we used for morning and evening devotions. That morning I brought in all the writings and the books to the front of the temple, and through the loudspeaker system I began to read each passage and saying from the book, and as I have seen written in the Bible about Jesus Christ. And I told them that according to the Vedas and Upanishads, He is the only true God. Only through Him we have salvation. There is no salvation in any other. He is the only true God, the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other God other than Him in the whole world, I told them. Thus I spoke to all of them that morning. Hearing this, my folks came forward. By the time the whole village had gathered up to the temple vicinity, all the learned people took my side and the unlearned took the side of my folks. He is speaking heresy and blasphemy, they accused me. The educated people replied by saying, But he is disclosing the hidden secrets. He is proving the writings that there is only one true God. Truly, this proves that he comes from a great heritage. I then read a prayer from Rudra Upanishad.
Ajatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amrutangamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
O God, we are in great unrest. Grant us peace. We are in unrest because of falsehood and untruth. Deliver us and lead us into thy truth, because there is true peace in thy truth. Lead us into thy light, O God. Lead us from destruction and damnation to eternal life. I then read from the Bible what Jesus had said. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. Quickly, I also read from Vishnu Purvam 10 and 6. This is what Vishnu is saying. This precious stone that you possess, which sparkles with great light, I am not worthy to wear it, because only the one who is light is worthy to wear it. This Samantakamani, or this precious stone, I am totally unworthy to adorn it. If Vishnu is not light, then he is total darkness. I then read from John 1:1-3, in him was light, and the light was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, but the darkness comprehended it not. And also what Jesus said, he said, I am the light of the world. He that cometh to me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. We who are in darkness are all headed for oblivion and utter destruction, because we are not able to comprehend that light, Jesus Christ. Now believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. In Vedas, Upanishads shows that there is only one God, that is Jesus Christ, who is the true God. In his blood that was shed, we have cleansing and forgiveness for sin. Hence, I am believing in him. Dear beloved people, won't you believe in him and have inheritance into eternal life? I told my village people. In response, they took me home, placed the meal before me, and as I was having my meal, they came upon me and choked me, bound me hand and foot, and with iron chains they beat me up with sticks and clubs. Oh, for 7 days they kept me without food and water. Every day they would come over and beat me up and scold me. As a result, both my hands were fractured. I became exhausted. My breathing became difficult. I became semi-conscious. Later they planned to kill me that night. I was bleeding through my nose. I was in great pain. My ribs were broken. Even though I was going through such great suffering, God's hand was with me. That night I do not know how the doors of that room were opened. I do not know how the Lord entered that room. He then took me and lifted me up and spoke to me, saying, My son, fear not. As I stood, my chains fell from my hands and feet. The Lord then spoke to me many things. I began to ask him all my doubts. I told him, Were you the one who was spoken in Vedas and Upanishads? He answered me that he was, and made me see his crucifixion on the cross and the blood that he shed for me. He spoke to me, saying, In my blood you have forgiveness of sin. I replied, saying, What then should I speak to the people? He answered all my questionings. I then took a very firm decision. Surely I will speak all these things to the people, Lord. Thus, after I had spoken to my Lord for 1.5 hours, I came out. On the way, the Lord appeared to me again and strengthened me by giving me drink. He showed me the path that I have to follow and all the things that I need to do. All this I had written in my book called Rujudarshini, which is in print. Please pray for it. In that I made it clear through that all Vedas and Upanishads that there is only one and only one true God, that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Dear friend, He is the hope of your life. Shun the path of error and accept the Lord Jesus Christ. You have been hearing the testimony of Paravastu Surya Narayana, brought to you into English in thought. You would have come to several conclusions by now, such as that religion is just a myth and man-made fables. Yes, it is, till it affects and changes life. When the divine, through his power and wisdom, transforms the character, then true religion is born as a fragrance. Or some conclusions like that there is no God, or there is no personal God that exists, but a gigantic power and a source that controls mankind, or that we are all in big mass of Godhead, universal God, our universal self, or that it really doesn't matter what really one believes, that all religions are the same, heading in the same direction. When truth confronts us, it shatters all the above man-made philosophical escape routes and challenges us to to face life squarely by adhering to it. Listen to this essential truth that will annul the above conclusions. Truth number one is that God has revealed Himself adequately through His Word, the Bible. It has no rival and it has withstood all the fiercest assaults. Truth number two, there is only one God. He is the Almighty God, the Great I Am, who says, "I am the Lord, there is none else, and there is no God besides me." Isaiah 45:5. "For there is no salvation in any other. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them." Exodus, the 20th chapter. Truth number three is the truth about sin. God is love. 1 John 4:8. He made all the creatures to manifest His beloved character. It was through pride and rebellion that Lucifer and one third of the angels brought sin and desolation to the world. We partake of sin by transgressing or going against God's perfect law of love that governs the whole universe. Thus all have sinned. There is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23-10. Truth number four is the truth about our Savior. We cannot free ourselves from sin either by good deeds, pilgrimages or sacrifices. But the good news is that God through His infinite love has come to our rescue. Jesus Christ, the eternal person of Godhead, the mighty God, has stepped down from glory and was born to take the place as our substitute. For He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our sins. He took our sins that we might have His righteousness, our death to offer His pure life. He was crucified on the wooden cross like a criminal and destitute to offer us a second chance of eternal life, that we might live the way He lived by His power. Truth number five is that the Lord Jesus is coming soon. After His death on the cross, Jesus rose again from the grave, ascended to heaven to prepare a place for those who follow Him. Revelation 14 says, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come." Truly, the judgment has commenced, where all the cases are being decided in heaven right now. Jesus is earnestly interceding for all those who follow Him fully. Soon, momentous events will shake the earth. The world will be divided into two groups over the issue of following God and His commandments or not. The great nations and legislations will compel the people to break God's laws given in the Bible. It says that He causeth all, free and bond, rich and poor, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead. This mark shows the decision of man to disregard God and His laws, especially the fourth commandment. Then, like a dazzling light bursting forth through the clouds, Jesus comes like a conqueror. The dead in Christ will rise, and along with the living who follow Jesus fully, they will all enter into the portals of heaven with Jesus, in a place where there is no more sickness, sorrow, or death or sighing, or tears anymore. Oh, what a matchless love God has given to us, friend. You are now at the crossroads of your life. The decision is all yours. Accept this great offer that Jesus gives to you and follow Him. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your matchless love for us. We want to follow You. Please show us the way, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have any further clarification, please do write to us in the address given.